We are live from the Sewell Center at Moon Township, Pennsylvania, and this is Northeast Conference Basketball on MSG. Today, it's the Central Connecticut State Blue Devils taking on the Robert Morris Colonials. Folks, we are inside the final 3 weeks of conference play. Only the top eight teams qualify for the NEC tournament. The higher seeds get all the home games, so Robert Morris is trying to maintain a spot in the top four. Hello again, everybody. I'm Paul Dottino, along with the capper, Tim Capstraw. Get your popcorn. Glad you could join us for this NEC matinee. And capper, we are really getting down to crunch time.
And we sure are. And Robert Morris, you saw that in the standings. Critical game for them. They've lost three games in a row. And again, the top four seeds get home court in the Northeast Conference tournament. So this is a huge, huge game for Robert Morris. For Central Connecticut, well, they have struggled all season long. This game, a win here today, could make their season.
All right, Capper, who are today's two key players to watch?
Well, for Central Connecticut, Matt Mobley, and he is a star as a sophomore, one of the leading scorers in the Northeast Conference and one of the best three-point shooters. And again, against the 2-3 zone that Robert Morris is going to present, his ability to shoot the ball and make deep threes or make plays will be huge in this game. And for Robert Morris, Marquise Reed, a six-time Rookie of the Week. Marquise Reed has a chance, Paul, to be not only a great player at Robert Morris, but maybe one of the great players in the history of the Northeast Conference. He's that special.
All right, Capper, today's starting lineups will be brought to you by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more in car insurance. Visit geico.com. You know, when you talk about the Blue Devils, they got to get a big game out of Drakeford, ranked 7th in the NEC, 7 rebounds a game, goes along with 13 points a pop as well. Head coach Howie Dickeman in his 19th season with the program, a four-time NEC Coach of the Year. Now on the other bench for the Colonials, got to look at their three-point shooter, Mr. Pryor, averaging nearly 14 points a game, 4th in the NEC at 40% from downtown. Colonials are directed by head coach Andy Toole. He's in his fifth year and has won the past two NEC regular season titles. Now, of course, Robert Morris has had some trouble with CCSU here in this building. Believe it or not, even though Robert Morris leads the series, CCSU has won the last two times they have come out here to Western PA. Today's officials are Robert Barker, Brandon Williams, and Dave DeYoung. Robert Morris is in their home whites and Central in their road blues. It'll be Peel and Seymour to tip it up. Check it, Peel and Minnie. And it will be Blue Devil basketball to open up the ball game.
Get used to this 2-3 zone of Robert Morris. That's basically what they play almost exclusively. And Central Connecticut has got to figure it out, how to get quality looks.
Followers of our conference will know that Lucky Jones is not in the starting lineup for Robert Morris today. Suspended, violation of team policy. A big loss for the Colonials. Peel misses the putback by Drakeford.
Excellent job by Ferrani Drakeford that time, getting inside position and able to obtain the putback. That's an advantage you can have against zone defense, your rebounding ability. Here's a zone of Central Connecticut.
Stewart. And lost it out of bounds.
Now, you alluded to it, Paul. Lucky Jones not playing in this game. That is, you know, he's had some injury issues this year, so they've missed him at times. So they are familiar with not having him on the floor, but that is a significant loss for Robert Morris.
Well, you talk about the 13.5 points and the 6.5 rebounds and the 30 steals on the season, but you also talk about the floor generalship that he usually brings, especially in crunch time of a ball game.
Yeah, he's like a 5-tool baseball player. You know, he can do a lot of things very, very well for a team.
Kevin Seymour, freshman point guard, will inbound it again as they get the new shot clock. Seymour getting a lot of playing time this year for the Blue Devils. Came in thinking he'd be a reserve, but has seen a lot of time. Mobley misses from outside, and back the other way comes Robert Morris. Here's Marquise Reed, a six-time NEC Rookie of the Week.
Rodney Pryor on the right wing. He's right here. The guy has the ball. They got better keep an eye on him. He can light it up when he gets hot. So can Elijah Mini from the outside, and he drains that. How about that? 6'8", a freshman, and has three-point range.
That is his 10th made three of the season, Capper. Shoots him at 41%. Central coming in only averaging 58 points a game on offense. They have had a lot of trouble scoring the ball. Leaner doesn't go for Seymour. And the Colonials will get it back the other way after the whistle.
Yeah, you are right. It's only about 57 points a game for Howie Dickeman right there. As always, the Central Connecticut Blue Devils play very, very hard, but it's their inability to consistently score. Those scoring droughts that have really hurt them immensely this season.
Now, on the other side, the Colonials are averaging 68 a game. That is fourth in the conference, but they have had a lot of defensive difficulties in second halves of games.
Yeah, sustaining their defensive intensity throughout the second half. Andy Toole, when we spoke to him yesterday, really talked about to see if they can maintain it the entire game today. Here's Pryor.
Reed thought about the three, takes the two.
Called it, a little shot fake at the three-point line and got himself in rhythm. And that's an example of the flat-out rookie of the year, hands down. He has a chance to be I don't think he's going to be a first-team all-league player, but boy, he is very close to that tall.
Sixth in the NEC at 15 points a game. Marquise Reed.
He certainly is deserving of some votes. A little contact with Minnie and Ferranti Drakeford on the perimeter.
First foul of the day on Robert Morris. Brandon Peel of Central had a foul a couple of possessions ago. And a little bit of a slow start, Capper. 2.5 minutes in, and Robert Morris is on top 5-2.
Well, you know, again, both teams are playing zone defense, so the offensive team has to kind of feel it out and see where the openings will be and present themselves. The high post area, Drakeford was open. Here it is right now. Well, it was open for a second. That's what makes a good zone defense right there.
Yeah, Kayvon Stewart got his foot in the way. The foul, by the way, was on Minnie, his first.
Well, you want to make sure you play through a zone, not around it. And you don't want to just settle from the perimeter. You want to have some attack mode with penetration either via the pass or dribble. That's good offense right there.
Peel kicks it back out.
It was good recovery time by Robert Morris.
15 to shoot. Mobley for Peel. Can't get it. Drakeford underneath has the ball stripped away by Pryor.
Everything but the finish. That was really good offense and didn't finish the play.
Minnie thought about the outside shot, took it to the rack, and is called for the charge. That'll be his second.
Yeah, credit Ferranti Drakeford with reading that play, developing, and then rotating over, making sure his feet were outside the restricted area. As Minnie left his feet, and he'll sit down now for a while with his second foul.
Steven Bennett's got to come into the ball game. Minnie, a freshman at 6'8", 210, has to learn to play a bit more under control.
Good-looking prospect, though. Very good recruiting year for Robert Morris. Great size, and then you got Marquise Reed on the perimeter. Wow.
Drakeford in traffic. Mobley back to Drakeford. Good look for Peel, and he wasn't looking for it.
Well, he's going to have to take that shot, Drakeford, because that's where that zone is vulnerable, and he's got to make Robert Morris pay a little bit so they crowd him and free up other people.
Pryor. And then around the perimeter again. Pryor's got range, not afraid to shoot from outside. That time tried to get it to Bennett.
Yeah, Bennett had sealed Mobley on the weak side. Just the pass eluded him. Rodney Pryor tried to dump it in.
Colonials have lost three of their last four, Capper. Upset by LIU the other day, 63-62 on this very floor. Reed missed a floater at the buzzer. This is a team that's been in a bit of a doldrums, and you know that Andy Toole wanted them to get off to a better start. Although they are on top, 5-2. Three by Cumberlander doesn't go. Tipped out, and the Blue Devils have another chance. Reed went for the steal, didn't get it. This is Drakeford, and a whistle on the play. And an elbowing foul before the shot. We'll take a quick timeout. Robert Morris is up by three. Northeast Conference Basketball is brought to you by Choice Hotels International, the official hotel partner of the NEC. And by Bayer, science for a better life. Paul Dottino and Tim Capstraw back in snowy Moon Township, Pennsylvania, where Robert Morris has an early 5-2 lead, and we are joined by another member of our crew today, Pat O'Keefe.
Well, hey there, Paul, and you know, playing shorthanded is really something that Robert Morris has gotten used to doing around here the last couple of years. If you remember last season, they had to play the final 17 games with just 8 able-bodied players, yet they still managed to win the Northeast Conference regular season championship. This year, it's been a bit of a similar story. a couple of injuries to key players like Lucky Jones and David Apollon, and some suspensions to players for violations of team rules have forced Andy Tool to shuffle the lineup in and out every game. The difference between last year and this year Tool doesn't really know who he has at his disposal from game to game. So he has said it's made it more difficult to game plan, more difficult to get organized. And a perfect example today, playing without his two seniors, Lucky Jones and David Apollon.
Thank you, Pat. You know, Apollon's got a shoulder injury, and this is the fourth straight game he's missed. It has coincided with their slump, Capper.
Yeah, well, on the defensive side especially. You talked about that earlier. Their second-half defense hasn't been where they should be, and that's what Apollon really does very effectively for Robert Morris. He's a glue guy, and they miss his glue.
Stewart for three. Too strong. Rebounded by Drakeford. And back come the Blue Devils quickly the other way. Mobley right to the rack. Doesn't get it. Rebounded by Gomez.
Again, another play not finished by Central Connecticut.
Lionel Gomez, number one, checking in. A little used reserve at 6'9", 230. A junior out of Senegal. A transfer out of Cloud Community College. Has made 18 appearances this year. Only scored 17 points in token action.
There's a lot of size in the front line. Can they hurt Central on the offensive backboard? Here comes Cumberlander out of the pack.
Off the air ball. Drakeford with the slam-a-jamma.
Well, big men run like that, reward them. Beautiful feed by Cumberlander, but credit for Auntie Drakeford. Love his effort early.
He's got both of the Blue Devils' baskets thus far.
A little different zone defense right now, trying to take away the angle. So, you know, it's falling back to have a two-fielder, a mini 1-3-1. Different kind of look here, but it's open up top.
Stewart for three.
The breakdown that time, leaving Kayvon Stewart the way he can shoot the ball open at the top of the key.
For Stewart, believe it or not, only his 8th three-point make of the season, shooting at 22%. Seymour into the corner, three-pointer, good. Well, Mobley.
That's Mobley, and that's what he does very well. Fourth in the NEC and threes made. And if you're Robert Morris, you have to really know in your zone defense where Mobley was. That time along the baseline was vacant.
Mobley may be the most improved player in the conference, Capra. Last year as a freshman, averaged 7 a game. Right now, third in the NEC at 16.5 a game.
Well, they needed him to step up. Remember, the backcourt with Vanellis and Malcolm McMillan is not here this year. They were expected, and they are not part of the Blue Devil attack.
Coming up on 5 seconds to shoot. Gomez guarded by Peel. Nice job in the low post. Gotta hurry. Reed gets it off. No, they'll say it's a shot clock violation, and so it'll be Central ball. You mentioned Kyle Vanellis playing professionally in Puerto Rico these days. As you get a look at Robert Morris coach Andy Tool, not happy with that offensive set.
Yeah, not at all. The ball didn't move, wasn't inside out enough, didn't swing it from side to side. And again, though, credit the Central defense. Defense not an issue for Central Connecticut. They play it very hard. That's why I admire the character of these players. They have never not played hard this year, Central Connecticut. It's just their ability to score enough.
Aaron Tate and Andre Frederick onto the floor for the Colonials.
Dale Pryor, Newer, Mobley. Here he is, open again.
An NBA three.
That is the guy. Boy, on the catch, that was quickly elevated in stroke. Good-looking shooter is Matt Mobley.
He's got two triples for six.
Again, he's just got to move him around. Notice how he was in the corner one time, then up top the next. Move him around against his zone defense so they can't anticipate where he will be. And here comes Mobley out of the pack again.
Central on top, 10-8, their first lead. This is Seymour and a whistle.
Like the way that Central Connecticut is trying to advance the ball quickly up the floor. That's another way to beat a zone that's very good. Beat the zone up the floor.
Andre Frederick picks up his first and the team's third. You see Peel take a seat. Stop at Jones, number three, coming in.
Let's see where Mobley moves to now. He's going to be up top on the right wing right here with the ball. They swing him around. There he is again.
For three! Off the back of the rim. Reed and a foul. Things rather disjointed in the early going, Cap.
Well, zone defense to do that to you. Kind of hard to get into the flow. And Holly Dickerman likes the way his team is competing right here, though. On the road, again, showing very good character, attitude and approach in a difficult, difficult season. Something that Holly Dickerman is not used to.
Callan Cumberlander picks up his first foul and the team's third. to the line for two. It's Marquise Reed.
Talking to Howie Dick and me before the game, and with his record right now at 3-22, I said, I'm the guy you should be talking to right now. I'm the guy that might be I'm an authority on those type of seasons.
Four points.
He didn't disagree.
No.
It's really upsetting.
4 points for Marquise Reed. 75% free throw shooter this year. He's really been a great surprise for this team. Tied at 10.
I think they got to move Mobley. Watch him go along the baseline. That's the critical guy to watch that Robert Morris has to keep attuned to all the time.
Seymour on the drive. And Mobley sticks the three just as called for.
Well, every part of the floor right now. He's got 3 out of 4 quadrants of the floor he's taken a three from and nailed it. And credit Kevin Seymour for finding him drifting along the baseline.
Mobley with 9. Suffice it to say, Andy Toole will say, keep an eye on 21 from here on out.
Well, we said that before the game. Here's another guy to keep an eye on, Rodney Pryor, who's been in the shooting slump, but I think he's a critical component to the success of Robert Morris in the playoffs. He's a guy that has the ability to light it up, and they need it.
That was his first basket of the day, and we are tied at 13.
Good pass. Good pass.
Drakeford, Cumberlander. Doesn't get the roll for two. Tipped up and controlled by Pryor. Pryor quickly into the forecourt. Under 11 minutes to play in the first half. Pryor picked up by Seymour. That's a mismatch. So Pryor fires the three.
That was not a rhythm three-point shot. That was like a kind of 9-1-1 three right there. You got to kind of make sure the ball comes to you so you can establish your feet, get in rhythm, and knock it down.
Problem was the operator didn't answer. Back with more NEC basketball after this. Follow the Northeast Conference on all your favorite social networking sites at NEC Sports. Get exclusive content and interact with the NEC on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube, Instagram, and Google+. They're all over the place. Also, be sure to check out the NEC's official website at northeastconference.org. The website features all the latest news and notes from around the league, as well as a link to the NEC's official web store, northeastconference.org. This is the early game today, Capper. Everybody else is playing around the league, but we have the early 12 o'clock start, and so far we're tied at 13.
Well, certainly other members of the NEC will be watching, especially Robert Morris. That is bunched up right now.
Yeah, they're looking to get a top four seed to get a first-round home game. They are, at the moment, 8-4 tied, or actually, yep. This is low, this is old, I just noticed that. Bryant's in second place.
They're tied with St. Francis University.
Exactly.
St. Francis of Loretto, St. Francis University for the third place. So those four teams are involved.
We had an old printout here on the scorer's table. I recognize that.
I did it to you. I did it to you again. Story. I like messing with you, pal. I'm sorry.
Seymour up top for Mobley. The three doesn't go.
I just crushed you.
And back Peel with the rebound as the Blue Devils reset.
I like the energy of Central Connecticut so far. They are active, enthusiastic, in attack mode.
In the lane, Jones for Peel. Sure he can. But gave it up instead. And now they try to pass it to us. Can you shoot?
No, can I shoot? All right.
Central 5 of 15 from the field. Robert Morris 4 of 8 thus far.
8 on the clock. They've got to work quickly. It's more difficult against the zone.
Cumberlander for 3.
Now the threes are raining for Central Connecticut early in this game. That is their fourth three. And they are playing very comfortable right now.
4 of 7 from downtown, as a matter of fact.
Let it fly.
That's Aaron Tate down low, number 24, working against Peel. And the pass goes through his hands.
Yeah, trying to hit a home run that time was Kayvon Stewart, trying to throw right through the zone. And again, Andy Toole is going to ask for some staying cool on the sidelines. Boy, for 34 years old, talk about an awful lot of experience. Andy Toole, unbelievable.
Well,
his record, his success, and just his coolness and his overall ability. Boy, some guys just have it.
Remember, he played at Elon, played at Penn, worked under Mike Rice here as they went to the NCAAs. then himself has gone to the CIT and two NITs. So you talk about a career, he's already had one.
Overall record of 102 and 63. Here's Minnie again. He made it earlier from there. Boy, the guard rebounds have been exceptional early on for Central. Getting back, digging back, and rebounding.
Cumberlander at 6 feet climbing the stairs for that one.
Confidence. There's a ball bopping around. Here's Cumberlander.
For three.
Not a bad possession. Minnie going up high.
And the lay-in.
Now, much like Central, Robert Morris wants to beat the Central zone up the floor. That way you have conflicts of responsibilities. You're not really sure who's supposed to guard who when it's early in the offense of the opposition when you're in a zone defense.
Fire brings the Colonials within one.
Extra attention paid to Matt Mobley right now. That's Rodney Pryor. Nowhere here he is.
Nearly got a look there, Cap.
Got to move him around. Good ball movement there.
Five to shoot.
Oh.
And through the hands of Cumberlander.
Right idea. Just a little too much heat on that one.
Substitutions once again. Gomez back into the game for the Colonials.
Got to be tough for Howie Dickerman this year, though. I mean, he has had so much success. I mean, you go to the tournament, you're four-time. Go to the tournament three times, correct? He's been a four-time Northeast Conference coach. We're wide open.
Touch pass and a slam by Bennett off of the feed from Gomez.
How was that wide open? Sometimes when you're playing zone, you don't apply enough ball pressure, and the vision to look right through a zone is too obvious. Well, you got to match up a little bit better than that.
Peel's turnaround is good. His first bucket.
Well, that's what Peel can do. He's more of a perimeter guy that can make the shots outside than he is in the interior on the block.
Pryor short. Skying for that rebound once again is Cumberlander. Mobley with the pull up. Sweet.
Playing great. We've seen the three that time. He pulled up and filled up.
11 points from Matt Mobley to lead all scorers. Central by three.
See if they improve their defensive alignment now. It's a little easy for Stewart there, right down the middle.
And Peel with the rebound.
They haven't given up second shots for Central either.
A lot of hustle in this team. Mobley can't get it, tipped up and controlled by Pryor. Three on two. Got his man, and Bennett finishes. He's got four.
Yeah, fundamental, good-looking fast break that time. Lanes were filled, and when you are a guard who doesn't finish on one end, you're very vulnerable to transition offense on the other.
Peel sticks another jumper, two in a row for four.
Yeah, off the short corner that time, that's a spot you can attack the zone defense. Get behind it, work the porch.
And now somebody hit the high setting on the microwave because things are heating up. Robert Morris with the ball down by three. Gomez harassed by Seymour. The spin move rejected by Peel. And they'll call it a goaltend. That's what it looks like. Back with more NEC basketball after this. Part of its commitment to good sportsmanship, the NEC continues to participate in the NCAA's Respect Campaign, a program designed to enhance the awareness of sportsmanship both on campus and within the community. Respect, it's the name of the game. 6:06 left in the first half. Our score, 22-21, Central on top. Kato Keefe is standing by on the sidelines.
In a conference, there's no question that Howie Dickerman is the dean of the Northeast Conference coaches. It's his 19th season. The second longest tenured coach in the conference is Tim O'Shea at Bryant. He's in his sixth season. Just to put it into a little perspective, Dickerman has 181 Northeast Conference wins at his alma mater of Central Connecticut State. The other nine coaches in the conference have a combined 268 wins.
And one of his prized pupils was Corsley Edwards, Capper, who last week was inducted into the NEC's Hall of Fame. Corsley, who not only was drafted in the second round by the NBA with the Sacramento Kings, also is now part of the player development program with the Denver Nuggets.
That is impressive. And the big dog, right? We used to call him the big dog. He was terrific. The lefty, much more quick off his feet than you would ever expect. Great hands, and part of those dominant teams of Central Connecticut.
Great. Mickens, another one of those terrific players they had. And I'll tell you what, it was a lot of fun watching those guys. Ron Robinson, Obi Wadicki over the years, Mojica, all those great names. Horton. What a fun ride for Howie Dickerman, although not so much this season. Right now, his team is up by one. Seymour running the show, gets it off to Cumberlander, back to Seymour. 10 seconds to shoot. They've taken a long time to set up this play. Seymour left it for nobody. And then Bennett flicks it to Drake.
Yeah, for no reason at all. What do they got here? They got to get the clock situation.
I think the possession clock was awry. Well, see, that's what happens when Claude Rains grabs the basketball. Our older folks will understand that. Our younger viewers have no chance.
Yeah, you got your references better get updated quick before the second half. Let's see what they got now. Peel coming to the high post. Here's Mobley. Good screen. Good set play. Knocks it down. That's good offense. What a pick and roll off the side wing of a screen that's up top, and the hot hand of Mobley continues.
He's got 13 points on 5 of 10 shooting.
Great looking play. Screening the zone on the side. Boy, you don't see that often.
Central by 3. And a whistle away from the ball. And it'll be on the Blue Devils. It'll be Kylan Cumberlander who picks up his second and the team's fourth. And we get Greg Andrade coming into the game for the Blue Devils to replace Cumberlander. Down low, Tate rejected by Peel, his second block of the day.
Going up with the left hand, rejecting.
Peel second in the conference in blocks with 40 coming in. Remember, Amdi Paul from St. Francis, New York, has 60.
That was a great job by Peel, though, protecting the rim. There he is again, Mobley. Oh.
Too strong. Peel fighting for that rebound. Knocked out of bounds. It'll be Colonial Basketball. Peel is only 6'7", 200 pounds. But Capper, second in the conference and 8.6 boards a game behind Jalen Cannon of St. Francis, New York, who's averaging 10 a game. And by the way, Cannon's got to be the favorite as the NEC's Player of the Year.
Yeah, I would be surprised if he's not. Well, he may have a stiff competition by his teammate, Brent Jones.
We'll talk more about those guys later on. Colonial Basketball, down by 3. 4:20 to go in the first half. Paul Dottino, Tim Capstraw, and Pat O'Keefe with you from Moon Township. Pryor fires short from 3. Seymour the rebound. Good. Finds Mobley underneath, and Drakeford has it smacked away. And it will be last touch by the Blue Devils.
Good pass that time by Mobley. Uncharacteristic of Bronte Drakeford not to control that pass and finish the play.
Yeah, but you can see, fundamentally speaking, Central's doing a lot of things that you want to do. They're just not getting the baskets.
Well, they're actually playing well. I mean, they're playing okay in this game because they defend hard enough. They got Mobley with a hot hand right now. Robert Moore's going to stay in that zone. That's really what they do. And if they can just keep moving Mobley around to get him decent opportunities.
Defense allowing the Blue Devils to have a 3-point lead.
And again, both teams playing zone, so it would actually be a shorter game. So there are longer possessions in this game because of the zone defenses.
Pryor pops, rolls off the rim, and another big rebound by Drakeford.
That's been a big factor, that the Central's rebounded the basketball. Limited Robert Morris, only one pass, plus they haven't overly turned over the ball.
Peel rejected by Minnie. Ready for it on the floor. The possession arrow favors Robert Morris.
And a good effort this time, especially at Aaron Tate. Talk about a toughness player. Kind of everything Robert Morris is about. It's Aaron Tate and the way they're playing. Right now, Central Connecticut is struggling this season, but playing very well in the first half.
Back in Moonshineship, Pennsylvania, Northeast Conference basketball. Central leading Robert Morris by three in the latter stages of the first half. Today's NEC Campus Spotlight is powered by NRG Home Solar. Visit NRGHomeSolar.com to learn more about solar made simple. Now, Central's got the Ammon College of Liberal Arts and Social Sciences being approved in January as they can begin some more construction up there with the new School of Engineering. Very proud of their program, are the Blue Devils. And on the other side of the ledger, for Robert Morris, they were ranked 24th in the nation by U.S. News and World Report for their online graduate programs in computer information technology. You know, when you talk about the NEC Capital, you're talking about modern and updated programs here. We're kind of with the times. That's why we do Twitter and Facebook and everything else.
Well, how about NortheastConference.org and what that can provide?
Ah!
The information that provides. Here's a big storyline. Matt Mobley, one of the leading scorers in the Northeast Conference, feeling it so far in this game. Playing exceptional.
Three triples. And again, coming in, we told you that he's shooting at 34% from behind the arc this season.
Out of a timeout, you get something special against the zone. It's harder to come up with special plays against the zone defense than it is obviously a man-to-man. But both of these team coaches have shown out of timeout special plays. Rodney Pryor looks like he might be getting something now on the corner.
Robert Morris, 8 of 18 from the field. Off the drive, Reed goes glass.
Well, that was pretty right there, and that was a beautiful ball fake. When you fake against a zone defense, you don't just fake one individual, you fake five players. And because of that, Reed was able to get an angle for the drive and finish.
6 points for the freshman. Oh, Stewart nearly had the steal. Seymour was coming. Too strong. Peel, another rebound. That is his fifth of the day. Cumberlander with the save, and then Reed with the steal. Here we go.
Let's not forget, Robert Morris, number one in the Northeast Conference in steals per game. Don't let the zone defense fool you. Andy Toole wants this to be an aggressive zone defense to take chances and shoots the gap.
Reed second in the NEC in picking pockets. That's his 45th of the season.
That side screen again from Mobley.
Central with the ball down by one. Coming up on 2 minutes left in the first half. Mobley thought about the NBA three. Wants Drake for it off the double team, and he's got the reward. 6 points for the senior.
A huge, important finish right there. He felt like there was a momentum swing, and Drakeford came up big. Some space for Reed. Maybe a little too quick on that shot. That's Marquise Reed.
Substitutions. Bennett back into the game from Mini. Andrade will take a seat. Cumberlander back in.
Again, both teams playing exclusive zone defense. This half is moving very, very quick. There haven't been many fouls. That's what will happen. You shorten the game when you're playing zone defense. High post area for Drakeford. Something special, the tap of the head. What do we got?
Seymour and Reed, two of the young guards in this conference. That's a good matchup. Cumberlander splits the D. The scoop doesn't go. And back the other way come the Colonials. Pryor to the right side for Reed, doesn't get it, tipped up by Pryor, no, he will try it again, off glass, doesn't get it, and then finally it goes down.
Sticking with it was Rodney Pryor that time. Quick second, maybe third leap that time.
Pryor with 7.
They're matching up a little bit more aggressively in this zone. They're kind of talking more, pointing more as Robert Morris and disrupting more.
Off the floater, and Drakeford gets the roll. He's got 8, and a quick Andy Toole timeout as Robert Morris is now down by 1.
Yeah, because Drakeford is making a difference in the interior as Robert Morris' defense is spreading out. The openings are created in the middle, and Central is doing a very good job of identifying that.
Drakeford coming in 13 points a game, has 8 thus far. Mobley, who's averaging 16.5, has 13 already. So those two guys are really carrying the load for Central.
They sure are in a low-scoring game. Take a look right here. The extra effort. Peel knocking it down. I'm sorry, Drakeford making that play prior to the break. And to make it, use it or lose it timeout for Andy Toole.
Let me just say something right here, Capper, before we even get to halftime.
Yep.
This Central team, which is 3-23 overall.
Yep.
They are playing with a lot of hustle. I cannot tell you how impressed I am with how hard they're playing for Coach Dickerman.
Yeah, that's no shocker. All about character. They got high-character guys, and what I noticed in warm-ups. They had about the most impressive 20-minute warm-up I've seen in a long time. Obi Wadiki, their assistant coach, is putting them through a number of drills. Here's Pryor, quick release.
Too strong, and again, Cumberlander skies for the board.
They can hold for one with the lead. This will psychologically do wonders for Central. They certainly do not need to turn the basketball over right now. Make sure they take the last shot of the first half.
20 seconds to go.
Take it about three or four on the clock, so you might have a chance for an offensive rebound.
Seymour pounding the basketball. Guarded loosely by Stewart. Mobley pulls up and knocks it down. 15 for Matt Mobley. And Central will go into the locker room with a three-point lead.
An impressive first-half performance, especially by Matt Mobley. But Central Connecticut just generally overall, and Howie Dickerman has to be very, very pleased. We'll get an opportunity to speak with him prior to entering the locker room.
15 for Mobley, 8 for Drakeford, and Coach Dickerman is standing by with Pat O'Keefe.
Success for you guys working against this Robert Morris zone in the first half.
We talked about before the game that we need to keep this in the low 60s to have a chance to win, and we're on a pace for that to happen. However, we have not been a good second half defensive team, but I hope tonight that we will be a much better defensive team. And we're moving the ball on offense, and we're getting the ball inside, and we're making shots.
All right, good luck in the second half.
Thanks, Dale.
All right, Paul, back to you.
Appreciate it, Pat. And thus far, they're also winning the battle of the boards. And that's been a big help for the Blue Devils as well.
It sure is. Whenever you're playing against zone defenses, rebounding becomes a critical component, and they're doing it well.
We're at halftime in Moon Township as Central Connecticut State and Robert Morris battle it out. Now let's take a listen on a colonial tale from two of their upperclassmen.
Lucky Jones, senior, guard.
David Eplin, senior, combo guard.
You know, obviously we haven't been to the tournament in 4 years, and it's been a long 4 years. And every year we've been there, we got there, we almost had it. You know, the year before I came, they almost had it in overtime. The year after that, you know, we made it. We had an injury problem, but, you know, we were still there to advance. And the year after that, we fall to the team that we lost to this year. And it's just like, you know, we're getting there, but we just got to find that oomph to get over the hump. And I really feel as though, you know, this team is a very special team. We got a lot of size, got a lot of talent, got a lot of people that can put the ball on the floor, a lot of people that can, you know, play defense. And everybody's in for one thing, and everybody just want to go to the tournament. And I think that's what brings us together, and I believe that this is one of the most special teams that Robert Morris will have in a lot of years.
I just feel like it's unfinished business. Yeah, we had a good, solid year as far as coming together with 8 players, but we still didn't get the job done. And that was the ultimate goal, was winning a championship. Everybody, I just think like the new guys we got coming in, they're going to help us a lot. As far as trying to get that goal, just like the coaching staff is going to push us to get that goal.
You know, we're not afraid of, you know, any competition. You know, we bring it out all every time. And just the mindset of coming here to work every day to know that, you know, we have a chance to beat a high caliber team. Every time we play somebody, you know, they get into the fact of, you know, we can't slouch on Robert Morris because, you know, they did beat Kentucky and they did beat St. John's.
There's times when people didn't even think we was gonna beat Kentucky. But the second game when we played, we had a lot of people that were saying we was gonna win, even though we still lost. But I think them wins really helped our program and helped Coach Till as a person because he worked hard. And he worked us out hard. So, and it gave us a lot of confidence as players.
When I first got here, it was just, you know, go down there and just screen and then come off. And then if you don't got the shot, just keep doing it. Now it's like, since we got a lot of more scores, a lot of more height, we can do different things. And that's what I believe that makes us more special than we ever been as a program. Being in that weight room, you got a lot of things on your mind, but just to remain focused and know that you got to get bigger, you got to get stronger, because it's a long season. And you're going to go through a lot of nicks and bruises. And just to have that
that preparation of not folding, not bending, getting through the workout, making sure that you're getting better, making sure that your team getting better.
Everybody believing in what Tool trying to do. And then I guess as long as we keep working on that goal, our goal as far as trying to get to the championship is going to only get easier. So I feel like everybody just got to come together like we did as far as last year with the EGOT.
What is our brand as Robert Morris? You know, we're a tough-minded team. We're going to go in there and be scrappy. We're not going to care who we're playing. And we're going to go in there and help each other out, go in there as a family and know that we got to stick together in order for us to win the game. And I believe that trend is still going to continue to go on and on. And I believe as long as Coach Tool, you know, stay with that mindset of pushing players to the max and the assistant coaches helping them do that, I believe that this program can go really far.
Yeah, there is some work to be done, but you can never count out Robert Morris in tournament time. Back with highlights and second half action after this. Back here at Moot Township, Pennsylvania, where Central Connecticut State owns a 3-point halftime lead over Robert Morris. Paul Dottino and Tim Capstraw with you. Capper, a well-played first half. Neither team is led by more than four. That was the Colonials' earlier advantage here this afternoon.
Well, I've been really impressed with Central Connecticut, a team that's really struggled throughout this entire season, playing with great energy and getting outstanding contribution from a sophomore we know well. And we knew we had Matt Mobley, had to have a big game. He's making threes. He's made three of them. Franzi Drakeford has been outstanding. And just the overall attitude and approach on the defensive side by Central has given them this lead on the road in a difficult season. I'm impressed with Howie Dickerman's team.
And Mobley, you mentioned him earlier, leading all scorers with 15 points. Let's look at the team stats, Cap.
Well, relatively even in a lot of areas, and that's why the score is so close right now. Three-point shooting will be huge. Can Central continue to make threes? And can they make sure they can rebound the basketball? Turnovers could be huge, though, in the second half, because Robert Morris leads the NEC in steals. And if Central Connecticut is careless with the basketball, they'll get easy opportunities the other way. They've got six fast break points. They want to make sure that they don't have them anything easy.
Our halftime stats cap are brought to you, as always, by Snyder's of Hanover. Discover the Preds' abilities. More NEC basketball after this. Central Connecticut with a 3-point halftime lead as we get set for the start of the second half. And Robert Morris coach Andy Toole is standing by with Pat O'Keefe.
Thank you, Paul. And coach, a big first half for Matt Mobley with 15 points. What do you guys need to do to slow him down?
Oh, we got
to
know where he is. You know, he got the first couple looks. I think we kind of lost him. He's doing a really good job of moving behind the zone and getting open areas. And, you know, so we lost him. So he was able to raise up and get going. And then when a good scorer does that, you get yourself in trouble.
How about offensively for you? Anything you want to change? Anything you want to clean up?
We want to move. You know, we a lot of standing around, a lot of staring, a lot of ball stopping. We got to keep the ball hot. We got to move our ball, move our body, and find some better looks.
All right, coach, good luck.
Thank you.
All right, we'll send it back to you guys.
All right, Pat Mobley with 15 points, 6 of 12 shooting from the field. Robert Morris has been led by Marquise Reed, who has 8, and Rodney Pryor, who has 7. Cap, when Mobley has the rhythm going like that, you know, they always say, well, you want to find him, but when a rhythm shooter has his rhythm, he usually hits.
Yeah, well, that's why it's so imperative for Robert Morris to make sure he doesn't get comfortable or be open at any time. I think that when a guy has got a shooting groove going, it's not, well, you know, obviously he'll keep it going if he's vacant, but you want to close on him. You want to know where he is. You got to point and talk if you're Robert Morris and really understand that he is the main factor in their zone offensive attack, and he becomes used. One thing he does, though, when he is open or he is being guarded tightly on the perimeter, it does open that high post area, and we saw Franzi Drakeford be able to take the advantage of this. There's some good passes by Cumberlander and Seymour to get the ball into the high post area. He and Peel can shoot the ball and really hurt the zone in that area also. And also in the short corner, as we look at Brandon Peel coming out, very good shooter to step off the floor.
You got to look at the other scheduled games in the NEC today. And again, this is important because Robert Morris is tied with St. Francis U for third place. They are third and fourth in the conference right now. The top four teams get a first-round home game in the tournament. It is Central basketball in their road blues as we start the second half, and they are on top by 3. This is Peel. rebounded by Marquise Reed. Reed, Stewart, Mini, Pryor, and Tate for the Colonials. Seymour, Cumberlander, Mobley, Drakeford, and Peel for Central. And another rebound by Drakeford. That's his fourth today.
Yeah, and he can really clean up the glass. And again, Central's done a very good job. Robert Morris only has three offensive rebounds. They've missed an awful lot of shots and only have three offensive rebounds. Defensive rebound has been outstanding in the Central zone defense.
The Blue Devils leading the battle of the boards, 19-16. Seymour for three.
Beautiful possession. The ball went inside out. Drakeford had it in the mid-post area and unselfishly quickly kicked it out to Kevin Seymour. Good offensive attack.
Seymour shooting at 29% from downtown. Only his 11th three of the year.
But that was beautiful because it was inside out, so he was able to step into it, Paul. Those are the easier threes to make. The rhythm threes stepping in.
Not for me. I can't make it for you. Stewart on the dribble drive. Tipped up and in by Elijah Mini. He has five.
How about that reach right there by Elijah Mini? Thought that ball was going way over his head. They're going to the post again. Play inside out with Drakeford.
He is guarded by Tate underneath.
Oh, high post. Right in the high post. See if they go. Oh, here's Mobley up top. Guy that you better make sure where he is.
Put it up by 12 to shoot.
Yeah, I got to play against the clock a little bit now. Here's Franti Drakeford.
Turn around. Doesn't go. Cleaned up by Mini. Knocked away by Peel into the Robert Morris bench. 27 to shoot.
Very good anticipation by Brandon Peel, knowing where the next pass would go. Mini stocks. Get a little feel for him. A confident freshman.
Pryor, up job for Reed, 15 to shoot. Pryor for Tate, the hook, doesn't go. And it's rebounded again by Peel. He's got six boards today.
It's like a clinic in how to attack zones, though. The right and wrong ways to attack zones. You get to see it up and down the floor. Both teams playing 2-3. Here's Drakeford, inside out. Good little ball fake that time.
Peel back outside for Cumberlander. And the key word today here, Cap, is patience.
Yeah, but not so much that you have to play against the clock down the way.
Oh, nice look! And Cumberlander can't finish, and Peel cleans it off.
Excellent job. But again, it begins at Bronte Drakeford. If he touches the ball in the high post area or anywhere on the floor on the inside, he really makes good decisions, and he's unselfish.
Behind the back pass, intercepted by Drakeford. He's got a 4-on-1. And they got sloppy.
Again, you got to finish that play. It was right there on a platter for Cumberlander.
Seventh turnover for the Blue Devils.
Here we get a look right here. It just kind of took his eye off it. He was concerned about the Rodney Pryor defending it.
Tough possession, Cap, when you have numbers like that. You want to finish the play.
But you can hear the confidence in the voices of the Central players defensively, especially Drakeford on the back line. He's like a middle linebacker directing traffic back there.
Colonial basketball down by six. Reed with a floater. Bit out of control. Tipped up. Tate on the putback. Doesn't get it. And then it's knocked down by Mini. He has seven.
Well, you see the importance of the second foul in the first half for Elijah Mini. He wasn't on the floor for the majority, almost all the first half. Had to sit down. He's back on the floor right now and impacting positively for Robert Morris. Again, will Drakeford get the ball again? Here he is.
He fought for it. Peel fighting for the board, and it's knocked out of bounds. Last touch by Robert Morris. Bennett and Gomez comes back into the game for the Colonials. One thing for sure, the Blue Devils will not lack for hustle. They may be limited in how many guys they'll use off the bench, but they'll give you everything they got. Peel guarded by Bennett. They got the new shot clock off the inbounds.
They're converging on Drakeford now. Now the guys on the perimeter are going to get shots because Drakeford got so much attention. Pryor did a good job on Mobley. Here he is.
So Mobley gives him a bit of an elbow, but Pryor's going to get called for the foul.
Well, he knew he got closed out hard on by Rodney Pryor, so he took advantage of it. Excellent job again by Central Connecticut coming out here in the second half with some confidence for Howie Dickerman.
The upset-minded Blue Devils of Central Connecticut own a four-point lead early in the second half. NEC Front Row is the official online digital network of the Northeast Conference with live HD webcasts, highlight packages, and full game archives. The state-of-the-art site is your one-stop shop for everything NEC. Best of all, NEC Front Row content is free. Whether at home or viewing on your mobile device, enjoy the best seat in the house at NECFrontRow.com. Let's head over to the sidelines for Pat O'Keefe as a special guest.
All right, thanks a lot, Paul. Standing by with Zach Lynch, a junior winger for the Robert Morris hockey team, currently ranked 18th in the nation. And you guys have a Division I best 8-game unbeaten streak right now. So what's been clicking for you guys?
Really, just everything. We're clicking on all cylinders, everywhere from our goaltending. We have two stellar goalies that we know we can win with any night. Our offense has been hot, and our D-zone's been just where we want it to be this year.
How about you personally? You're ninth in the country in scoring in the last 8 games, 17 points. What's with the scoring binge?
I was in a bit of a slump, me and my line, for about 6 or 7 games, and we just recently broke out in a good way. And I play with guys like Cody Wido and Scott Jacklin, so it's a lot of fun to play with, and not too hard to put up points when you play with guys like that.
All right, keep up the good work. You're having a great season. Paul and Capper, back to you guys.
Thanks, Pat. Pittsburgh, a good hockey town. In fact, a real good sports town, and they can appreciate Matt Mobley, who has 18 points.
Well, great job. Robert Morris came out scrambling, trapping on defense that time, and the extra pass by Kevin Seymour found Matt Mobley. Robert Morris trying to shake it up defensively.
Mobley 7 of 13 from the field, 4 of 8 from downtown.
It's an excellent job by Seymour. They're locating him under duress. The second pass out of the trap is always open, and it ended up in the hands of Matt Mobley.
The 7-point bulge, our largest lead of the day. 15 minutes to play. Colonial basketball. Marquise Reed, who led them with 8 points in the first half, has yet to score here in half number two. Mobley with the steal.
The absence of Lucky Jones in this game cannot be minimized. The direct pass.
And we got a whistle here before Drakeford made his move. It'll be on the Colonials. You mentioned Lucky Jones, Capper. You see him on the bench, a violation of team policy, not dressing today. A guy who averages 13.5 points and 6.5 rebounds a game and is the glue on the floor for this team.
Yeah, they're missing him. You can tell right now. Him and Apollon, again, the Apollon, the defensive specialist. The problem with both of these teams is they struggled in second halves defensively. And Robert Morris wants to see if they can turn it up defensively. Central wants to see if they can continue to score in the second half. That's where they have really struggled.
Gomez picked up his first foul, by the way, for the Colonials. That is a three. And Cumberlander knocks down his second triple of the day. He's got 6.
Boy, things the offense looks a whole lot better when shots go down, and Central Connecticut is knocking down threes.
It is a 10-point Central lead.
Play zone defense, and it's a shorter game. A 10-point lead is a big lead. Again, oftentimes the clock winds down. Here's Reed.
Way off on the bomb. And the putback by Tate with the follow, his first points of the day. Aaron Tate has 2. So, Cap, let me ask you about the way this defense has been set up. Now, Andy Cool, 2, wants timeout for Robert Morris. This defense, this tough zone defense these teams are playing, some people will say, well, maybe up and down offense takes a lot of energy, but playing this kind of defense can wear you down too.
Well, it can if you're playing it well, and I don't think Andy Tool is really satisfied with the way his team is playing it right now. They are just breaking down there, and that's why he's calling, they're utilizing an early timeout right now. Again, when we spoke to Andy Tool yesterday, he said, we play defense well for the first half of games, and then we don't play the same focus and intensity when we come out at halftime. And I think that's why he's utilizing this early timeout. We see the opening right here as Kalen Cumberlander looks really good stroking it right there, knocking it down. And Central Connecticut has had poise. Their execution has been effective. And Howie Dickerman, again, in a very difficult season, really likes what he's seeing so far in this game.
Well, Mobley and Cumberlander are the Blue Devils' two best outside three-point threats. And so if you're Andy Toole and you see one of those two guys getting a good look from behind the arc, you know that's a problem.
Well, but let's give Central credit because they got the ball in the hands of Fronte Drakeford in the interior for a lot of us for the beginning of this second half. And what that does is make the zone defense sink. It sinks down in, and then the openings occur. There are other ways in the first half. They were making threes early. That expanded the zone to open up the middle. To start the second half, Central's gone with a different philosophy of going inside first and then create the openings after that.
Get a look at Cumberlander, a sophomore out of Washington, D.C. Averages 9.5 points per ball game.
If there's anything different in the zone defense, kind of extending up a little bit higher right now. That's a 1-2-2 kind of, or 1-3-1. Kind of look for Robert Morris. See the mini right there staying almost attached to Mobley. They're going to kind of match up right now. Here's Mobley open.
4-3. No surprise.
No surprise, but Robert Morris tried to do something different that time. Match up and then stay attached man-to-man. I think they got confused. And great job moving Mobley to the other side of the floor quickly so he could be open.
Short jumper off the rim, tipped up. No good by Bennett, and now Central comes down with it again. With the lead pass for Peel, incomplete and knocked out of bounds. It will be Central ball once again. So for Mobley, already with a game-high 21 points, that is his 10th 20-point effort of the season. He's got three 30s as well, including a career-high 32 against Sacred Heart. So he is not done yet.
No, he's not done yet. He's made 7 of 10 threes prior to in a game earlier this year. And you can see it. It looks like it should go in when he releases it.
Yep. Reed anticipating the pass. Comes up with the steal and the block by Mobley, but he'll be charged with the goaltend.
You gotta be careful of against his zone defense. Reaching out in the gaps. Right here, you get a peek. Right anticipation by Marquise Reed. Make sure you want to use some ball fakes. You want to fake the zone and make a pass. Fake a pass and make a pass to create some opening.
Reed with 10 points. And I believe Howie Dickerman actually called for time here. His club is on top by 9.
Well, he wants to make sure his team doesn't get careless right now because Aaron Morris behind right now is going to take more chances in their zone defense. You saw that with Reed in that last possession. They've trapped on a couple of occasions. You have to identify what they're doing defensively and secure the basketball. Play confidently, but play intelligently. That's what Howie Dickerman is stressing right now in his timeout.
You know, over the course of the last decade or so, Capper, Robert Morris has won like 70%+ of the games in their building. They've been very intimidating in here, but Howie told us when we talked to him, hey, my guys have won the last two times they've gone to Robert Morris. We're coming to play. We're not going to back down against these guys.
Obviously, right now, led by that gentleman, Matt Mobley, and his shooting ability, 21 points. All right, extended. First time we've seen this. A little 2-1-2 or 2-2-1 pressure by Robert Morris to give a different look.
Freshman point guard out of the Bronx, Kevin Seymour, number 5, runs the show for the Blue Devils.
The baseline is about open. They're very extended up on the wings as Robert Morris right now. He's jumping up on the baseline.
Mobley, Cumberlander, Peel, and Drakeford also on the floor for Central.
Really high on the wings.
5 to shoot. Cumberlander for 3. Short. Tipped up and controlled by Stephen Bennett. Reed all the way to the basket. He has 12.
Excellent job pushing it up the floor. And you see the versatility in the offhand. One of the future, or really right now, one of the great players in the Northeast Conference, Marquise Reed, 6-time Rookie of the Week. That is impressive.
He leads the Colonials in scoring today.
You see this adjustment, how the back line seems very high up there. They're taking some chances and kind of matching up. More of a matchup zone. Almost playing man-to-man right now is Robert Morris. They're giving a look of his own, kind of playing man-to-man.
Peel can hit from there. Doesn't get it. Tipped up. No good by Drakeford. And Reed pulls it down the other side. Nearly traveled. Got it to Minnie, who fires. The rebound by Frederick. Air ball. And Drakeford has it for Central.
Yeah, Howie Dickerman's got to figure out exactly what this defense is doing right now and what to call. He wants to help out his team. They're standing around quite a bit right now. A lot of stationary movement right now. Then they get into their movement late. Oh, great look.
Drakeford. Peel. He has eight.
Beautiful feed by Kalen Cumberlander right there. Right through the teeth of the zone. Straight line pass that Robert Morris didn't see coming. And then the quick leaping ability of Brandon Peel again after the miss.
With sophomores like Mobley and Cumberland, those are keepers. Here's the dribble drive, and Reed has 14.
Too easy, though. A couple times he's been able to slash and go to that offhand. Marquise Reed getting aggressive on the drive. There, again, again, very high up and taking some chances. How can Central distort this? That's it, right there.
Drakeford off the feed from Peel. That's 10 for Drakeford, his first 2 points of the second half.
Great, quick decision by Brandon Peel. He made that play right there. High post, knew his partner was down below. Bounce pass, and the defense is very high right now. So they beat him along the baseline.
Reed trying to take things over by himself. And there's the rebound by Minnie. So it looks like Marquise Reed has decided he wants to be the spark plug on the offensive zone.
No doubt, he is going for it again. Here it is, a little opening. Peel. Peel and Drakeford's unselfishness has been huge in this game. Looking for each other, looking for their teammates.
And Peel growing with this team. He's only a junior himself. Reed with the steal. And the frustration foul by Kevin Seymour, his first.
Taking chances as Marquise Reed effectively trying to help get Robert Morris back into this game. His quickness has been excellent, but outstanding execution. Peel to Drakeford has Central rolling.
You're watching Northeast Conference basketball on MSG and Fox College Sports Atlantic around the country. Central Connecticut Blue Devils with a 48-39 lead over Robert Morris with 9.5 left in the ball game. For information on how you can save 15% on your next stay at any Choice Hotel property nationwide, simply visit the NEC's website at northeastconference.org and click on the corporate partners link to learn more. Let's go over to the sidelines at Pat O'Keefe.
Well, Paul, as you can imagine, Andy Toole very frustrated in the Robert Morris huddle. His team trailing by 9, having lost 3 of their last 4 games. He repeated about 6 times in the huddle, "It's February. It's February." As if to say, I can't believe we're still making these mistakes. Central misses a layup inside, and the Robert Morris guy is standing around while Peel puts it back in. Too many open looks for Central. Very frustrating afternoon so far for Andy Toole.
Well, again, let's understand. Robert Morris right now tied for 3rd and 4th with St. Francis U, and only the top 4 teams get a first round home playoff game. And as you know, Capper, if you have not been one of the top 4 seeds in the NEC tournament, you have not won the NEC championship bid.
I gotcha.
It's a requirement. You gotta be one of the top 4. That's just the way it goes down. Speaking of going down, Marquise Reed has 16.
Yeah, he is heating up right now. Marquise Reed really trying to take over. A little different, little diamond press right now. Some length, essential. Can they execute without turning it over? Can they handle the pressure in the corner? That's a dangerous area. And a quick timeout by Kalen Cumberlander.
Howard Dickinman not at all pleased with how they got him trapped.
Yep, along the baseline. You want to work the middle of the floor if you can. It's caught him a little bit by surprise right there, but if you know what's coming right now and you know how to execute, you can get yourself some easy opportunities.
Robert Morris at 18 of 44 from the field, just under 40%, and Central is 20 of 45 for 44%.
But the huge stat in this game for Central Connecticut is 8 of 15 from three-point land. There's no doubt about it, the ability of Mobley to go 5 of 9, Cumberlander to make a couple, and Seymour, the guards making their threes has been huge for Central.
Central also out-rebounding Robert Morris, 27 to 24, Peel with 9 boards on the day. Leading scorers, Matt Mobley with 21 for Central. Ferrante Drakeford has 10. And for Robert Morris, Marquise Reed has 14.
Yeah, Marquise Reed is heating up. And right now, though, Central have the poise. They haven't been in this position all that often this year with a lead. They're getting a little careless with the basketball. You see the deflections beginning to occur for Robert Morris.
Remember, Howie Dickinman only goes with a 7-man rotation.
See the ball fake he utilized up top? That's when we got him wide open.
Mobley for 3.
That's good coaching, though, by Howie Dickinman. He told him, said to use ball fakes so the entire zone would jump out and take chances. Fake a pass and then make a pass.
Reed tried to dribble through traffic, and there's a foul. I believe it may be on Drakeford. Let's see. It is. That is his second and the team's third. In a very clean ball game, Capper, but as you said, that's where the way zones tend to lend themselves to.
And fast, but really played quickly.
Pryor for three.
Oh boy, here they come. Now they can set their pressure. Lucky Jones likes what he's seeing. Look at the size of Mini up top. He's tough to shoot through. Good fundamental step through the trap up the middle of the floor. And here's Mobley. Now Robert Morris is not going to lay. I don't think they're going to lay back much in this zone.
Robert Morris draws within four.
Yeah, exactly. Only there's no reason to be crazy defensively, though. They did a great job in the last couple of minutes cutting down this lead.
It was 11. Cumberland, who thought about the three. 6 seconds to shoot. Peel's turnaround doesn't go. Mini has the rebound. And here come the Colonials.
And here comes a confident Marquise Reed. We look to make a play. High screen game.
Has 8 of his 16 points here in the second half. That's a three. Doesn't go by Mini. Peel the board. His 10th of the day.
Maybe a little quick and too early on the clock for that shot for Elijah Mini.
Coming up on 7.5 minutes to play. Central with the ball and a four-point lead.
No reason to panic for Robert Morris. They've done a good job getting back into this. Matt Mobley, can he get freed up? Here he is with the ball. Drakeford trying to get open inside the baseline.
Seymour thought about three and then thought the better of it.
Good ball movement.
Cumberland off the mark.
That's the kind of shot you have to have go down. That's a very good offensive possession. Now the attack is Rodney Pryor.
Colonials hitting the boards a little bit harder the last couple of minutes, too.
You can sense the momentum shift.
Reed from the top of the key. Peel fights for the board and has it.
Yeah, big board right there. See, the second chance opportunities haven't been there for Robert Morris because of the rebounding of Peel and Drakeford.
Peel in the corner.
Don't be cautious. You know, you can't just play around the zone. You got to play through it some. Ball fakes.
Mobley up top, guarded by Reed. Again, 10 seconds to shoot. Mobley pulls up for the air ball, and it's pulled in by Tate. Colonial basketball down by four. Pryor with a crossover. It finishes.
Sweet right there, Rodney. Pryor in the open floor. Andy Toole liking what he's seeing. He said, get that pressure. Extended. There's Minnie's length.
Kick ball. Pryor, by the way, with 12. And you can now sense this building starting to come to life.
Here it is. Rodney Pryor and company of Robert Morris making a run here in the second half.
Back in Moon Township, Pennsylvania, Central clinging to a two-point lead in the latter stages of this one. And let's take a look at today's W.B. Mason delivery of the game.
Well, there have been a lot of good passes, but this one from Peel, Brandon Peel, down to Ferrante Drakeford. That's the W.B. Mason delivery of the game. Outstanding execution.
W.B. Mason Office Furniture and Supplies. You can't go wrong when you buy right at W.B. Mason. You get a good look at Ferrante Drakeford with 10 points and 6 rebounds today. He's played very well.
But the energy and momentum has shifted dramatically. Robert Morris on a 7-2 run right now. They've got the field is central. Can they find some composure? Extended pressure. Elijah Mini, that length. He's going to be on the ball, and he's going to trap the first pass. They are going to be the aggressors right now, Robert Morris. Central's got to have poison and be able to execute.
And the spot plug for the Colonials the last few minutes was Marquise Reed, who is right now taking a rest on the bench. Here's Mobley. Peel and Seymour. Drakeford. And Cumberlander on the floor for the Blue Devils.
Has the ball gotten inside in a while? It's been a while since it's been in the high post area. Mobley along the baseline. Can you find him?
That's a three. Doesn't go. Cumberlander the rebound, and it's knocked out by Gomez. He's on the floor with Bennett and Pryor and Stewart.
Great effort there again by Drakeford, keeping it alive. Extra possession at a time when every possession is magnified.
Mini also on the floor for the Colonials. New 35, and Peel brings it outside.
Man-to-man right here by Robert Morris. It's something different.
That's Mobley. Guarded by Pryor. Gets it to Drakeford. And the blocking foul is charged to Stewart. That is his first and the team's third.
New clock now for Central. Back up to 35 and Howie Dickman directing traffic.
With 5:22 to play.
Man-to-man. Haven't seen much of this in this game by Robert Morris. Pick and roll game with Seymour. See if Mobley can make a play. Mobley Pryor is the key matchup.
Peel wants the ball. They get it to him, and then he's unable to maintain possession. So Stewart comes back the other way for the Colonials. Nearly traveled, but put on the brakes in time. Pryor's three off the back of the rim. Would have given Robert Morris a one-point lead and erupted this building.
Robert Morris can look, Central can look more comfortable. Now Robert Morris shifts back to the zone defense now. They played that one possession of man-to-man. Now they're going to extend out of it. Now they're going to close and play man-to-man. It's like a half zone, then they go to man-to-man at about 20 seconds on the clock.
Oh, good pass. Drakeford finishes it off. Mobley found him down low.
With all the quality shooting Matt Mobley has done, that might have been the best play of the game right there. Off the dribble, beautiful delivery.
12 points for Drakeford, and now Central is up by two possessions. Have they stopped the bleeding? Baseline jumper is an air ball by Bennett.
He was open. See, obviously you got Marquise Reed at the table. If they're waiting for a stoppage of play to get Reed back on the floor, they may have to use a timeout to get him back out there.
Cade will also come back into the ball game. 15 seconds to shoot for the Blue Devils. And the steal. Mini then gives it back up.
And a new clock again for Central.
Andy Toole just checked with his bench, found out he's got three timeouts remaining. Yep. Central has two.
Again, Reed has it. You give him a little bit of a blow, but sometimes you can't get guys back out there quick enough.
Here comes Mobley right to the rim.
How about that, Matt Mobley? Big time drive and finish.
He can beat you from deep and he can beat you from close.
Certainly today he is.
23 points for the sophomore out of Worcester, Massachusetts, Matt Mobley. Eight coming here in the second half, and he's got Central on top by six.
Well, you got to respect his deep shooting ability. He's already made five threes in this game. The hard close on him, and he knew they were going to guard him tight. A little subtle ball fake, and then a straight line drive to the rim and finish. Big time.
Mobley, the third leading scorer in the conference at 16 and a half a game.
Let's take a peek at this right now. You had the angle right there on Bennett, and was able to drive against zone defenses. Oftentimes, you can be mismatched against a player that doesn't have the ability to defend you one-on-one. And that was a good read by Mobley right there, knowing they had the long and lengthy Bennett about 20 feet from the basket and to attack him. Bennett was anticipating a screen to his side, and he got a great angle to go right directly to the basket. Big-time read.
It'll be Colonial basketball with 3:17 to go, down by six. You get a look at the leading scorers. You know about Mobley. Marquise Reed has 16 for Robert Morris.
And Central changes up too. Finally goes man-to-man in this game.
Reed gets it to Pryor.
Two on the ball. Who's open?
Over Peel. Three.
Wow. Big shot by Rodney Pryor.
He has 15. And the Blue Devils break the pressure. It is a three-point Blue Devil lead. And they'll slow it down again as Howie Dickerman barks out signals from the central bench.
Mobley along the baseline. That's what Robert Morris is talking about right now. They're pointing and talking about number 21 in blue.
Reed guarding Seymour.
Clock is late now again.
Five to shoot. Peel against Tate. Gotta hurry. So he flings up a prayer and a shot clock violation.
So that's the danger of being cautious and really being overly patient versus his own defense. You end up not only playing against the opponent, but the clock. And that's what got Central in trouble in that last possession. How about Pryor's three prior to that?
Northeast Conference basketball is brought to you by Choice Hotels International, the official hotel partner of the NEC. And by Bayer, science for a better life. With 2:24 to play here at Moon Township, Pennsylvania, Central Connecticut is trying to complete an upset. They have a 52-49 lead over Robert Morris. Matt Mobley with 23 to lead all scores. Ferrante Drakeford has 12 for Central. Robert Morris getting 16 from Marquise Reed and 15 from Rodney Pryor. Glad you could join us on this NEC matinee. Paul Dottino, Tim Capstraw, and Pat O'Keefe with you. And I don't think you want to go anywhere because this one may go down to the wire.
Zone back to the zone by Central Connecticut.
And Marquise Reed back into the ballgame for Robert Morris.
Pryor along the baseline. Pryor and then Reed on the left.
Stewart on the floor. I think that may have been an alley-oop intended for Pryor, but it's knocked out of bounds by Central. 21 to shoot.
Kind of a risky pass.
Kevon Stewart to
time.
Inbound.
But Peel unable to come up with the rebound.
And he got to fix the net, so Brandon Peel does the honors. I could never do that, being only 6'1". And the pass goes all the way into the backcourt for Marquise Reed. 15 seconds to shoot. Reed splits the defense, picks it up off the floor, and gets the roll. 18 for the freshman.
How did he make that play happen? Big time. Again, here's the pressure.
1-point game. Seymour for Peel.
Very difficult play by, again, the outstanding rookie of the year, Marquise Reed. Okay, now who's the go-to guy, and how long is Central going to wait to get into attack mode? Again, they don't want to play against the clock. Man-to-man defense by Robert Moore. It appears that way, and it's a little point and talk.
10 to shoot.
Man-to-man look, that's for sure.
Cumberlander. Seymour. Underneath. And it's going to be a violation.
What do they got here? They got to decide. Is it behind the backboard, or did they have a 35-second violation? Or would they go look at it to make sure?
Well, the ball never hit the rim, so shot clock violation is the easy call. That's how Dickerman looks on. In any event, it's an empty possession for Central at a critical time of the ball game.
Right here, you got Seymour coming along the baseline. Doesn't finish the play.
They're going to go look at the monitor. This is one of the great reasons that I love replay capper, because you want to get it right. It's a 1-point Central lead with 1:20 to play. Robert Barker, Brandon Williams, and Dave DeYoung are three officials today.
Try to get a feel for this off the replay as Kevin Seymour goes on the baseline. I don't think it hits anything. And then Mobley goes up. But the ball was deflected by Elijah Minnie. And should there have been a violation call if Elijah Minnie blocked the shot of Matt Mobley?
Let's see it again.
The ball does not hit any part of the backboard. The ball ends up in the hands of Matt Mobley, but here's Minnie touching the ball. That should have been maybe a live ball. Let's see what the officials are calling right. I think they called that it hit the back part of the backboard and it should be dead, but let's see what they have.
I don't know that it did, Tim.
Yeah, I don't know that it did.
And at that point, it would seem to me the play's still alive. Let's get a look.
That's why it should have been a live ball.
But we don't wear the striped shirts, and so we will have to wait to see what they decide to rule again after looking at the replay. Remember, folks, this is a critical game for Robert Morris. The top eight teams in the NEC standings go to the NEC tournament. Higher seeds will always get the home games round by round by round, and Robert Morris right now is fighting for that fourth spot in a first round home contest.
You get a glimpse of the clock up top, and you felt like there was a very hard to see in the screen if there was any time remaining when the ball was tipped. You felt like there was a little bit of time. It'd be interesting to see what they have. We'll try to get the officials' attention to give us an interpretation.
It looked like one of the side officials was calling a shot clock violation while the official under the basket thought that it might have hit the backboard. So that's why they were in dispute. Andy Toole looks on from his bench. Howie Dickerman looks on from his bench. And we'll look at it again. I just don't think it hit the backboard, Cap. And then Minnie with the deflection to knock the ball away at the end of the play. And it looks like they may have to look at it one more time.
Or they may have to peek again to see if there's a... One way you can sometimes tell is if the ball, the rotation of the ball changes. Sometimes you watch the seams of the ball to see if that changes at all. I don't think it did. I don't think it hit anything.
You're talking about the seam of the ball. Well, who are you, Ted Williams?
Well, obviously, no. That's exactly what you do, though, to judge if it hit anything.
And the officials continue to monitor this replay. It does not look like the ball hit the backboard. The seams never change direction.
You like that.
Well, here's what we do know. It's a 52-51 Central lead. With 1:20 to play. It is certainly crunch time, and every possession is critical. Howie Dickeman now with Andy Toole in front of the scorer's table trying to get an explanation.
Well, I think they're going to put 1 second on the clock for Central Connecticut right now. But the inadvertent whistle, because remember the ball ended up in Fronty Drakeford's hands. How much time do they have?
Well, 1:20 is on the game clock. Right now, zero is on the shot clock. They're going to have to fix that if they want Central to inbound the ball. Now they put 1 second on the shot clock, and Mobley will trigger it in. And here we go. The catch and shoot by Drakeford. Off the rim, Peel fights for the rebound. Stewart stepped out of bounds. Oh, no, they'll say he was able to bounce it off of Peel, so it will be Robert Morris' ball. So what was the ruling, Cap?
Well, the ruling was an inadvertent whistle when Fronty Drakeford actually had the ball, and there's 1 second remaining on the clock for Central Connecticut.
I'm glad they sorted it out.
Now they got it right.
Robert Morris basketball, down by one with 1:10 to play. This is Reed in traffic, and he draws the foul. So we have 107 to go and a new shot clock for the Colonials. It's on Mobley, his first and the team's fourth.
You see the contact right there, but only the team's fourth foul.
Each team has two timeouts remaining. Reed goes all the way into the backcourt, passes deflected away by Cumberlander, and we get a whistle. And Marquise Reed can't believe it. He's just been called for the foul. His first and the team's fifth. And Andy Toole doesn't like the call either. Nor do the fans.
Oh, the ball was thrown all the way into the opposite backcourt right here. And Cumberlander going for it. And they got Reed on the foul. Look at this.
Mobley, the baseball pass into the backcourt for Seymour. And the Blue Devils have it with 1 minute to play.
Tough call.
Here comes Mobley. Rejected from behind by Minnie. Peel pokes it away. A scramble for it. It's a rugby scrum. And the possession arrow favors Robert Morris.
Great effort by Drakeford again. Doing a little things, getting on the deck. But Andy Toole trying to keep some order with his team right now.
Central calls for time with 49.9 seconds to go.
Look at this mad scramble that occurs right here and how quick to the floor everybody is on the floor. But Fronty Drakeford with those unbelievable hands and veteran ability understood the call. Timeout immediately, and he got the timeout.
Now, initially, they flashed for the possession arrow, and now the officials are talking about it at the logo capper. I do believe that Drakeford got time, and the Blue Devils can have the basketball. With 49.9 ticks to go. So, Drakeford has made a number of big plays today. He's made some good shots. He's made some very nice passes. He's skied for some rebounds. And right here, he may have come up with the biggest possession of the day. Out-of-town scoreboard, LIU with a one-point lead over the Red Flash. And the officials are going back to the scorer's table again, and they will take a look to see if Drakeford did get timeout. Are the advantages of modern technology. Central Connecticut on top by one with 49.9 seconds to go.
Officials want to know how much time to put on the clock. Make sure there's a proper amount of time when Franti Drakeford called a timeout. Hustling, scrambling, calls it there. Seems like it was a little bit over 50. Make sure they get the clock correct. Obviously, in the last minute of play, every second matters.
Howie Dickeman was just over at the scorer's table also looking for clarification.
Well, right now, Central's got to understand they're up one. They have one timeout remaining. That's important to tell your team. You're going to be aggressive.
Looks like they will leave the clock at 49.9, Jim.
Okay.
And put 34 on the possession clock for Central, and Mobley will trigger.
Well, Robert Morris can be incredibly aggressive because Central wants to use a little clock.
But Central with the ball and a one-point lead.
Not so much, though, that they, again, they play against the clock. Stay confident and aggressive in your offense. Attack, go at the basket.
There's a 15-second differential. This is Cumberlander, guarded by Minnie. 10 to shoot for Seymour. Here's Peel. Cumberlander with the scoop. The rebound by Drakeford again, and he's called for steps with 15.7 seconds to go.
And securing the rebound, but falling back, Franti Drakeford. Now, right now, you're Robert Morris.
Do you call for time?
Well, I don't know if they're going to right now. They want to run a play that they've worked on. They call them right here as they get over half court.
With 13.3 ticks to go.
And here is the situation for Andy Toole. Obviously down one. Wants to call a play. Wait. Watch this play right here as Cumberlander goes along with a slide shot. Doesn't convert. Drakeford comes down. A little bit off balance. Got him for a travel right there.
Now remember, Robert Morris was in a similar position on Thursday, trailing LIU by one. They got the ball to Marquise Reed in the final seconds.
Yes.
He drove to the left of the lane with a floater that misfired, and LIU came away with a one-point upset.
Well, Andy Toole is very good in these situations, designing end-of-game plays, and he can better be in the hands of probably Reed or Rodney Pryor to attack the basket. You want to be aggressive. You want to go at the defense some. You also want to take this shot with about three or four on the clock so you have a chance again for the offensive putback rebound.
Cumberlander, Seymour, Mobley, Drakeford, and Peel for Central. As they come out onto the floor, trying to defend this one-point lead.
Almost always you see teams obviously go man-to-man, but Central's had so much success in their zone defense. I wonder, will they go zone?
Stewart, Tate, Minnie, Reed,
and
Pryor.
And eyes on Reed. He has been their go-to guy, possibly Pryor also inbounding the ball. They're always possibly the most dangerous guy on the floor, the inbounder.
Here's Reed with 10 seconds to play. Guarded by Mobley, the reach in and the foul with 8.1 ticks to go.
Great job going early on the clock, though, understanding that that will occur. Again, another foul to give. They got another one right now to give, so you want to attack quick again if you're Robert Morris. He's going to attack, maybe they get the foul.
Reed again foul outside the arc by Mobley. 16 foul on the Blue Devils.
Well, the next one is 1-1, so there'll be no more intentional fouls.
5.3 seconds to go. Aaron Tate to trigger. Robert Morris has one timeout remaining. Peel will defend. Kick ball.
The double team Marquise Reed if he gets the ball.
Here goes Reed. Floater in the lane. Doesn't fall. The tip is good. And Robert Morris escapes. The official. officials will go to the replay, but I do believe they will score the goal. Aaron Tate with only his second basket of the day, if it stands, will have given the Colonials a 53-52 win. And Howie Dickaman can't believe it. The officials will go to the monitor again. And for the third time in the last 2 minutes, the officials have to look at the video replay.
Well, and as big a video replay as you will see, if they tip it prior to the clock expiring. Yeah, you see the light. It was tipped prior to the light going on. It's official. Robert Morris with the win, and a huge one for Andy Toole.
For the Colonials, a big one at home. 53-52 over Central. Back to wrap this one up after this. Back in Moon Township, Pennsylvania, where Robert Morris escapes over Central 53-52. Our Bear player of the game has got to be Marquise Reed, who led the Colonials with 19, but it was Aaron Tate who won it with a tip-in at the buzzer. Both of those players are standing by with Pat O'Keefe.
Absolutely, Paul. We will speak with both of them. Marquise is our player of the game, but let's start with Aaron Tate. It was your tip-in at the buzzer that won this game, and just kind of walk me through that final play and what you saw.
Well, I didn't really see anything. When we was in the timeout, I was telling myself, no matter what, I'm going to crash as hard as I can, because if he misses it, I'm going to try to get the rebound. If he make it, then we're good. But that's what I was telling myself. So when he shot the ball, I ran in there, tipped it, and it just bounced in.
They had to review it to make sure it was good. Did you know it was good after you tipped it in?
Oh, yeah. I knew it was good, because I was looking at the ball bouncing when the lights was going off on the rim.
Congratulations. Huge basket.
Thank you.
One of his two baskets today. Now, Marquise Reed had a ton of them, and he led the comeback in the second half here. And first off, just the effort of your teammate.
That's he not worried about scoring. He just coming into play his role. That's crash, get defensive rebounds, and then make open layups. So that's just a blessing to have a good teammate like that.
You guys faced a double-digit deficit midway through the second half. What did you do those final 9 or 10 minutes to pull this one out?
We definitely had to tighten up on the defensive end and get some more rebounds. They out-rebounded us in the first half, so we had to bring some intensity, some urgency, and intensity second half.
How about your performance and just kind of the way you became even more aggressive than you usually are offensively and took control of this game? What were you thinking in the second half?
In the second half, I knew I had to be more aggressive for us to win because I'm our leading scorer, and if I'm not scoring, then it's hard for our offense to flow. So I'm not scoring, that's what motivates other guys to get involved.
When you came over here, you had a smile on your face. It was almost like a sigh of relief. In terms of the standings, this would have been a pretty devastating loss. For you guys to have avoided that, how good does that feel right now?
That's a real good feeling to know that we can save our spot for tie for third place and hopefully move up the charts for the playoffs.
Overall, just in terms of momentum, what can a win, a dramatic win like this, do for your program going forward?
That just give us a chip off our shoulder and for us to come back ready to practice on Monday.
All right. Good luck and congratulations.
Thanks.
All right. That's Marquise Reed leading the way to another Robert Morris victory.
Thanks so much, Pat. And be a short road trip to Bryan and Sacred Heart coming up in the next week. But right now, the Colonials able to defend their home turf. They knock off Central at the buzzer 53-52. Back with more from Moon Township to wrap things up after this. Moon Township, Pennsylvania, Northeast Conference basketball. We just had a barn burner. Robert Morris steals one over Central Connecticut State, 53-52 on a buzzer beater. The eighth time capper in the last 5 years that Robert Morris has won a game in the final 10 seconds. They're pretty good at this.
Yeah, they are. They sure are. And just a great effort. As you see this play develop, no surprise that Marquise Reed is in the middle of it. He's in attack mode. He shoots the shot at the proper time, but almost three on the clock. But there's Aaron Tate doing what he can do, getting on the offensive backboard. Great job by Tate. During his interview with Pat O'Keefe, he said, I just knew I was going to attack the glass in case he missed. And you see that so often in college basketball that it's not the first shot, it's the second shot. And I think it's just great that such a terrific kind of role player, a true glue guy, and Aaron Tate, who does all the dirty work for once in his career, gets to be the flat-out hero today. Yes, Marquise Reed was great. Pryor was great. But Aaron Tate is the guy for Andy Toole getting it done.
All right, so 18 points for Reed, 15 for Pryor. Tate with the two baskets, including the winner. Let's not forget Central, though. What a tremendous effort today. In fact, they out-rebounded Robert Morris 34-31, but they didn't get that last rebound. It was a great game by Matt Mobley, 23 points. He was very impressive.
Now, Matt Mobley was good. Ferranti Drakeford was good. And Central played very well for about 31 minutes. The last 9 minutes of the game, Paul, they only scored 4 points. It's hard to win that way. Congratulations to Robert Morris for coming back. Central just didn't have enough offense down the stretch of the game.
Interesting point as well. Robert Morris, only 2 free throws. Central, 0. Very clean game.
No, very clean. Zone defenses will do that.
All right, folks, we're glad you could join us for this NEC matinee. We try to bring you the best in basketball right here with the Northeast Conference. Once again, our final score, Robert Morris, 53, Central Connecticut, 52. We will be back on Thursday when Central Connecticut hosts St. Francis of Pennsylvania. Please check your local listings. This telecast is a copyrighted production of the Northeast Conference and was produced in association with PS Wolf Media. For Tim Capstraw, Pat O'Keefe, and our entire crew, this is Paul Dottino saying so long, everybody.